graphic audio. A movie in your mind. Graphic Audio LLC presents Galactic Football League 6, The Gangster, Part 1, by Scott Sigler. Narrated by Michael John Casey and performed by a full cast. Galactic Football League 6, The Gangster, Part 1.
Damage that sculpture, and I'll replace it with the diorama made from your severed feet.
Two laborers, a worker and a human, froze in place. Wearing matching light gray coveralls, they stared up at Gredok, who watched them from his throne atop a white 3-meter-tall column. The human stopped breathing. The worker's cornea swirled with threads of pink, and his muscular pedipalp arms began to tremble so badly he had to hold them with the hands of his thick metal arms. They were tasked with packing up Grand Tetet Mints, a small ancient sculpture of a stylized human head, flattened like the blade of a knife. The bronze sculpture rested atop a pedestal, which stood in a niche built into the chamber's curved wall. One of the treasures Gredok kept on display here, Grand Tet Mints, was priceless, irreplaceable. Sculpture and pedestal alike needed to be removed to make space for a new treasure. The laborers did not move. They stood there, staring up in fear.
Birok.
The warrior stepped out of his small alcove set in the pillar's base, opposite the chamber's double doors. Normally, the round room's deep shadows would have helped mask Birok's movements. But with the delicate work in progress, the overhead lights blazed full and bright. The eyes of the laborer shifted from Gredok to Birok. The warrior towered over them, 375 pounds of muscle and scarred, thick, engraved, enameled chitin.
Get back to work.
The laborer scrambled to obey. They moved clumsily, too fast. The human bumped the worker. The worker bumped the pedestal. The knife-head sculpture teetered, tumbled off, and dropped toward the floor. Firok caught it in one pedipalp hand. The warrior's chitinous lids narrowed on his single baseball-sized eye. Threads of black swirled across the cornea.
Be more careful.
The human nodded. The worker's cornea flooded solid pink. Firok set the sculpture atop the pedestal. As he returned to his alcove, Gredok watched him. The warrior moved slower than normal, likely still feeling the effects of being shot twice in the chest by the assassin Jonathan Sandoval days earlier. Virok would soon be fully recovered, the two fresh chitin scars witness to his devotion to his shamakov. But if Virok had done his job, he'd have killed Sandoval as he'd been ordered to, and Hokor the Hook Chest would still be alive. The Hook Chest had to be replaced, a seemingly insurmountable task. Massal the Efficient was planning Hokor's solidity ceremony. In 5 days, players, fans, the media, and more would gather to pay tribute to the two-time Galaxy Bowl winning coach. Gredok wanted a grand ceremony, something spectacular, something that appropriately reflected the Hook Chest's exemplary career. Gredok owned the Krakens. Gredok owned Hokor, yet the Hook Chest was the closest thing to an equal that he had known in a century since Gredok had been an underling himself. Hokor was now neither underling nor equal. Hokor was gone. Gredok should have been basking in the glory of Ionath's third GFL title, yet the Galaxy Bowl victory felt hollow. Hokor had refused Gredok's direct order, rushing off to help Virok and Quentin fight Sandoval instead of escaping danger with his shamakov. Gredok wanted to believe Hokor had done it to protect his players, or perhaps Hokor had done it to help buy Gredok more time to escape. Deep down, however, Gredok suspected a darker motivation, Hokor's loyalty. The most important aspect of the Quith culture had waned in those last moments. At the end, perhaps Hokor hadn't been loyal to Gredok at all, but instead had been loyal to Quentin Barnes. If only Sandoval had survived, Gredok would have applied a myriad of tortures to the human. But Sandoval had not survived. Barnes had killed him. Barnes had succeeded where Gredok had failed. Jason Prochnow, a Kraken, had been part of the attack. He'd helped Sandoval get aboard the touchback. Prochnow had apparently planted the lethal bomb. Sandoval had killed Prochnow, a fitting end for a traitor. But the question that plagued Gredok was, who had paid Sandoval. Jack's owner J.T. Manis was the most likely culprit, trying to derail the Krakens before the title game. But if not Manis, Gredok's thoughts shifted to Gloria Ogawa, then to Anna Villani. The Krakens had defeated Villani's orbiting death in the playoffs for two straight seasons, denying her a chance at GFL glory. Her hatred and violent ways knew no bounds. Her influence continued to grow, as did her appetite for more power. Maybe another owner was behind the attack, or maybe someone in Gredok's own syndicate. An up-and-coming underling like Stedmore Osborne, for one, had much to gain by impacting Gredok's reputation and power, if not killing him outright. But Osborne had his own team now. He and shipwright Manny Syed owned the Buddha City Elite. Osborne had made the move without requesting Gredok's permission, perhaps an indication of fraying allegiance. Then there was Barnes' strange relationship with the Prawat. Barnes had spoken to Petra Prawat, their living god. He wondered if enemies of that biorobotic race had hired Sandoval. So many possibilities, so many variables, yet someone was responsible for Holcor's death. Gredok would find out who it was, and that sentient would spend a century praying to die. The laborer slowly and gently lowered Grand Tet Mintz into a custom-built crate. Then they sealed the crate as he sensed their bodies finally relaxing, heard their heart rates ease slightly. They rolled the crate out of the chamber, the heavy doors closing behind them. After the solidity ceremony, the empty niche would be filled with a new piece of art, a life-size stained crystal representation of Holcor the Hook Chest, sculpted by none other than Mun O'Tallow. O'Tallow's skills were expensive and sought out by the richest beings in the galaxy. When it came to celebrating the memory of the greatest coach in Kraken's history, Gredok would have only the best.
Shamakoth, shall I return the lighting to normal?
Yes.
The chamber dimmed, leaving only a ring of illumination where the round walls met the ceiling. Shadows reclaimed their proper place. Lights in the 12 niches lit up Gredok's treasures, the paintings, sculptures, and artifacts that had served as witness to his wealth and power. The double doors opened slightly. Missal the Efficient stepped into the chamber. The worker wore a smooth crimson jacket with braided bronze trim, perfectly tailored to his slim torso and thick middle arms. Jacket and black pants alike were immaculate as always. Gredok noticed hints of silver in Missal's well-groomed black fur and wondered if Missal would start dyeing his fur to hide his age, as Gredok did.
Shamakoth, I have the player updates you requested, as well as my first report on available coaches.
Players first. Start with Barnes.
He is still on the regulator and will be coming out of deep rejuve later this afternoon.
Barnes had taken significant damage during the Galaxy Bowl. After the game, Doc Patah had put Barnes under. Before Gredok knew about it, GFL Commissioner Rob Frost had taken the unconscious quarterback from the Jupiter Stadium to the Regulator, a former battleship turned League headquarters. Frost had cited an imminent danger to Barnes, an insinuation that Gredok could not protect his own property. Somewhere down the road, Gredok would deal with this little human commissioner. For now, though, Froze wasn't a high priority. Barnes was. The human's Galaxy Bowl performance was sublime and spectacular. He had plucked victory from the jaws of defeat. While Rebecca Montaigne got the glory, capturing MVP honors, Gredok had no illusions as to who had delivered the win. But whether or not his injuries would heal correctly, and his thunderbolt of a left arm would be as strong and as accurate as it had been during his record-setting 26-86 season to deliver another championship, was in doubt.
When can Pata examine Barnes again?
Unknown at this time. Commissioner Froze informed me that he will send for Dr. Pata after Dr. Ganagati has finished her exam.
Ganagati, the GFL's top doctor, was known for her surgical brilliance. Gredok had once tried to bully her into letting Barnes play despite the quarterback's obvious concussions, but Ganagati had not backed down. Pata was an excellent team doctor, but Ganagati was a level above. And under her care, Ganagati fixing Barnes' arm wouldn't cost Gredok a single credit. Barnes was a once-in-a-generation talent. If he returned, the Krakens would be favorites to win a third straight Galaxy Bowl, a feat accomplished only once in the GFL history. If Barnes could not perform, Gredok needed to know and know soon. Montaigne had played well enough to beat Jupiter, but she was no franchise quarterback. Nor was third-stringer Trevor Haney. To replace Barnes, Gredok would have to find a top-five QB. And although losing Barnes would hurt the franchise's bottom line, it would also bring a long-awaited satisfaction. The human would finally learn the cost of his insolence.
Shamakoth, shall I continue?
Yes. What does Potter say about the status of Chodo the Bright?
The linebacker had suffered a horrendous leg hyperextension in the first round of the playoffs against the Buddha City Elite.
Dr. Potter feels we must wait and see. He last examined Choto 2 days before the attack on the touchback. The leg is recovering, but until it is healed, there is no way of knowing how the injury will affect Choto's speed and lateral movement.
Choto was part of the Krakens' strong linebacker core. Virok Damin on the left, John Tweedy in the middle, Choto on the right. Backup linebacker Pishore the Fang, now heading into his third season with the Krakens, had shown great promise and eventually would become a starter. But for now, a healthy Choto was a significantly better player.
That exam is now a week old. Potter should have given you a more recent assessment.
Missal brushed a pedipalp hand back across his six antennae, a sure sign of news that Gredok would not like.
Choto is with Barnes on the regulator, as is Rebecca Montaigne.
The warrior had abandoned his commitment to Gredok, his Shamakoth, and instead pledged fealty to a human. Choto would either heal and play, or he would not. Only then would Gredok deal with the warrior's betrayal.
Tell me of Michael Kimberlin.
Dr. Potter says Kimberlin needs time to recover from the season. However, testing indicates Kimberlin's overall strength has dropped 4% from 2686 preseason levels and is down 6% compared to 2685 postseason testing.
A 6% decline. Unfortunate. Kimberlin is 32 years old, yes?
33, Shamakoth.
No matter a player's skill, strength, speed, or intellect, there was no escaping the stalking specter of age. 33 was fairly old for a heavy G player. When their big bodies finally started to give out on them, they declined rapidly. The Krakens did not have a backup guard talented enough to replace him.
When you look for new players, prioritize quality backup linebackers, starting offensive guards, and starting linebackers. But focus your skill on finding me a potential starting quarterback. Find me a diamond in the rough.
Among Missal's long list of qualities, the worker had become an excellent assessor of talent. On top of that gift, the worker's accountant mind also kept track of the most important part of any franchise, the financial bottom line. Missal did everything he was asked, and then some, going above and beyond in all categories. In a galaxy filled with threats, Gredok took solace in the reliable, consistent performance of his most loyal underling.
Running back may also be an issue. We have received a formal negotiation request for Jew Tweedy. Considering our salary cap issues, it will be difficult for us to re-sign him.
3 years earlier, Anna Valani had wanted Jew Tweedy dead. Gredok had offered Jew a simple choice. Sign a 3-year deal with the Krakens at league minimum and be protected by Gredok's organization, or face Valani's wrath alone. Jew signed. That contract had expired halfway through last season. With the season over, Jew's agent, Danny Lundy, would push for a huge deal. No more bargain contract. Now an unrestricted free agent, Jew was the best running back in the game and a major factor in Ionath's back-to-back titles.
Can we afford to pay what Lundy expects?
No. Analysts predict Jew will land a record-setting contract for his position. Signing him at market rates would put us well over the cap.
Gredok had found a way to make Quentin Barnes sign for far less than the quarterback was worth and wondered if he could find a way to make Jew Tweedy do the same. Then again, if Barnes did not return, there would be ample cap space to sign Jew to a large contract. The Krakens would have to find a far lesser quarterback, but it could be done, making Ionath a run-first team. To make that strategy successful, Gredok would need the right coach.
Out of the candidates to replace Hokor, who would you say is the best choice?
Higan Yang. He coached the key New Fangs to a key conference title and barely missed a Tier 1 berth when his team lost to the McMurdo Murderers 35-32 in double overtime in the Tier 2 tournament semifinal round. Higan has a balanced offensive attack, focusing equally on short passes and running the ball.
Ah, key. Who else is on your short list?
Bagel the Fishy. He guided the Citadel Aquanauts to a Tower Conference title. They were blown out 35-3 by the Dione Colicants in the first round of the T2 tournament. But the Aquanauts were the top rushing team in all of Tier 2. If you wish to rely on Jew Tweedy's ability, the Fishy would be a leading candidate.
Bagel was a proper quith leader. Gredok waited for additional names, but Massal offered none.
That is your list. Two coaches?
They are the best available candidates. I am still reviewing potential Tier 3 coaches.
Replace Hokor the Hook Chest with an unproven Tier 3 coach? Very well. Are there any other player issues I need to be aware of?
Luciano Kretzelfinger has made it known he would like to try out as a receiver instead of as a defensive back. The request has reignited tensions between the Sklorno and Prawat players.
With receivers Denver, Milford, Holowa, Tara the Freak, Jaboygan, and Haywick, the Krakens were loaded at that position. Perhaps if the Krakens shifted to a run-heavy offense, Kretzelfinger might be trade bait to bring in depth at offensive line.
Understood. Is that all?
One additional issue, Shamaka. It seems that George Starcher's sanity is again in question. He's been using a false name and appearing on fringe broadcasts talking about conspiracy theories.
Humans and their fragile minds. What name has he been using?
George Karcher.
What is he talking about on these broadcasts? His old ones nonsense again?
No, Shamakath. He has bought into a minor conspiracy theory that involves an alien invasion fleet from another galaxy. The Abernesia.
From another galaxy? Do the simpletons who peddle these imaginations even bother to learn the most basic elements of physics?
Apparently not, Shamakath.
Starcher was another Massal discovery. The human could be exhausting, but he had played well and was possibly on the verge of a breakout season. For his talent level, Starcher's contract was a steal.
Inform him that everything he does reflects on this franchise. He's not to appear on any further broadcasts without my express permission.
I will tell him, Shamakath.
Gredok heard a soft buzzing that would have been silent to most, but not to him. Missal's palm up giving an alert. The worker raised a pedipalp hand and read the message.
Wakan Reed is en route to Ionath. He will deliver his report on the attack to you personally.
Both the Kredorakian Empire and the Planetary Union were investigating the incident, yet neither government had given Gredok any useful information. The leader had many questions, and hopefully, Wakan had answers.
Also, Zogby will be here momentarily. He has a new ring setting to show you.
Bring him in as soon as he arrives.
It should have been the greatest time in his life, 3 days since his team had won the GFL championship. In a perfect reality, Quentin Barnes will be celebrating with his family and friends, endless media interviews, reveling in the moment, praising the hard work and sacrifice of his teammates, telling the universe how proud he was that the woman he loved had delivered against all odds and been named Galaxy Bowl MVP. The victory, the glory, he couldn't enjoy any of it. A cornerstone of his life's very foundation had been ripped away. And most important of all, his very reason for being was at risk. Coach was dead, and possibly so was Quentin's football career. So he wasn't celebrating. He was in a hospital gown, his naked butt on an exam table, the exam room's cool temperature raising goosebumps on his skin.
You're saying you agree with Doc Pata. You don't think I can play again?
Doc Ganagati didn't answer right away. She was a hurrah, like Doc Pata and most GFL doctors. Ganagati hovered in midair, wings undulating gently. The hurrah species had evolved on a gas giant planet. They had almost no reason to rest on a chair, a couch, the ground, or any flat surface. Hurrah always floated.
Let me finish the exam, then we will discuss it.
Her words came not from her wide mouth, but from speaker film lining the white box strapped to her broad back. Enameled on the box's flat top, the GFL logo. Quentin had been aboard the regulator for days, most of that time in a deep rejuve. But to Quentin, It felt like the Galaxy Bowl had ended yesterday. Pata had told the injured player that there is no recovery from an injury of this kind. He will never again throw with any degree of accuracy, let alone the pinpoint targeting that made him what he was. That his career was over. Quentin lived for the game, for the thrill of each pass, each run, each tackle, for the roar of the crowd.
I want your prognosis. Not later, right now.
The tips of Ganagati's mouth flaps pressed together.
I do not appreciate your tone, Mr. Barnes.
I don't care what you appreciate, Doctor. Tell me.
Ganagati's sensory pits widened slightly.
And if I don't, you'll threaten me, like you did with Dr. Potter?
Quentin leaned back. He felt his fury drain away. In its place, embarrassment and guilt.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to come across like that.
Her mouth flaps tapped together twice, the hurrah equivalent of a nod.
Take a moment to get yourself under control. I am almost finished with the exam.
Wings rippling, Ganagati floated to a row of holotanks. She called up diagnostic scans of Quentin's body. Quentin hung his head, the memory of a shameful moment making his face flush with heat. In a rage, he'd told Doc Pata that if he crossed Quentin, then he'd kill him, forcing the doctor's promise to keep Quentin's arm injury a secret. Pata, a trusted friend, a confidant, and Quentin had threatened his life. At the time, Quentin felt he'd had a reason. If Gredok the Splithead suspected Quentin's football career was over, the Quith leader might come for not only him, but all the sentients he loved. But now Quentin was here, on the regulator, while Pata was probably back on Ionath with Gredok. He could only hope Pata would keep his medical opinion to himself. But if Ganagati said Quentin could still play, that trumped anything Pata had to say. If she felt Quentin was finished, it would get back to Gredok sooner rather than later. Quentin wished Rebecca was beside him. She, Fred, and Choto were on the Hypatia, Quentin's yacht, which was docked in the regulator's landing bay. Frost hadn't asked Quentin's permission to move him and the Hypatia to the regulator, but Quentin didn't mind. Considering that someone wanted him dead, hiding inside a battleship seemed like a prudent move. The door to Ganagati's exam room slid open. GFL Commissioner Rob Frost strode in as if he were 7 feet tall, twice his actual height. The door slid shut behind him. Ganagati shot across the room, her rippling wings a blur of motion. She stopped sharply in front of Froze.
You do not enter my exam room unannounced. I am with the patient.
Froze wore a white button-down shirt and a red tie embroidered with the GFL logo. Quentin thought of the outfit as Froze's uniform, considering the short human never seemed to wear anything else. Even Froze's teeth were red, a strange physical feature Quentin had yet to see in any other human.
You work for me, Ganagati. Do you forget that?
A situation that will be instantly remedied should you ever again interrupt the sanctity of my exam room. Do you understand?
Froze stared at her for a moment, then glanced at Quentin. Quentin shrugged.
Don't look at me, Kamish. She just put me in my place a few seconds ago.
Ganagati had stood up to Gredok the Splithead. Quentin had seen it with his own eyes. It should have come as no surprise she would not back down from Froze, even though the half-sized human was her boss.
Answer me. Do you want me to continue on as your chief physician?
The commissioner scowled.
I do.
Then you will not do this again, correct?
I won't do it again.
That Froze would kowtow to her showed the commissioner thought she was the best in the business. Froze jerked a thumb toward Quentin.
I want an update on him.
The hurrah spun away from the commissioner and returned to her holotanks.
You'll get your update when I'm finished. Leave.
I don't mind if he stays. You'll tell him the results anyway.
Ganagati hovered silently for a moment.
Very well. Let me give you the overall results first.
Quentin felt his anger rise at a longer delay. The pain of losing Hokor had him on edge. Every emotion felt raw, undiluted. But Quentin would not be the puppet of his emotions. He would rather master them. After all, he'd learned from the best. Gredok the Splithead.
Most of Mr. Barnes's injuries are significant, but manageable. The broken right clavicle is healing. I expect full range of motion to return in 4 days, as long as he continues 6 hours of daily rejuve therapy.
4 more days of sitting in the rejuve tank was not what Quentin had hoped to hear. But if that's what it took, that's what it took. He'd hurt the collarbone during the Galaxy Bowl, possibly fracturing it before finally breaking it with his game-ending sack of Jack's quarterback, Don Pine.
As for the hip bursitis, it should heal in a week or so.
Quentin's eyebrows rose. I have hip bursitis?
Significantly so. Is there a reason you tried to hide your hip pain from me?
The hip had hurt, but after the game, just about everything had hurt.
I don't know. It didn't cross my mind.
The next time a doctor asks you what hurts, perhaps you should spend a moment thinking about your answer. You football players assume that living with pain is normal. It is not.
Froese adjusted his tie.
Can we please get to the real problem?
Problems, plural. The nerve damage to the left arm is an issue, but so, too, are the repeated concussions. Mr. Barnes, it is my responsibility to inform you that you are already showing signs of chronic traumatic encephalopathy.
Froese shook his head.
This again? So Barnes suffers CTE, so what? Every human player in this game does. Post-career treatment is excellent.
And not always successful. Mods to the human brain carry their own risks.
Retired GFL players had access to the same medical technology legally available to any sentient in Kredorakian space, but not active players. Active players were forbidden from using any artificial body modification technology. Doing so brought the risk of being kicked out of the league, or worse, as Kredorakians showed zero tolerance. That meant players had to live with injuries that could otherwise be cured, including possible brain damage. Quentin was only 23 years old. With any luck, he could keep playing for another 15 or 20 years, maybe even another 30, before he retired.
I'm aware of the CTE risk. I'm aware of the concussion issues. Please, doctor, can we get on with this?
Ganagati's mouth flaps tapped together.
Very well. As for your throwing arm, Dr. Pata is correct that the nerve damage is severe. It is inoperable by current standard procedures.
Current standard procedures? Is there something that's not standard?
Ganagari paused. For the first time, the hurrah seemed uncomfortable.
There is something new. An experimental procedure for repairing nerve tissue at the atomic level.
Sign me up.
Quentin slid off the exam table.
It is not that simple. The screening process eliminates most candidates. 96% of those considered weren't suitable for the procedure.
Quentin gestured to the rows of equipment against the wall.
So screen me. Let's get on with it.
There is only one facility that can do the screening and the procedure as well. It's on Earth.
Quentin shrugged.
I don't care if it's all the way out on the reef. Let's do it.
Hold on. Right now, you're safe here on the regulator. There are sentients who want you dead. Trip to Earth is risky. You comfortable with that?
I'll go in secret. I've got people to protect me.
The real risk isn't in the trip. 12 individuals have undergone this procedure. One person was cured. A success rate of under 10%. As for the other 11, the procedure made their situation worse. So much so that 4 of the patients later committed suicide. There was nothing we could do to mitigate their pain.
Froese tilted his head.
Doc, you used the word we. Let me guess. The only place that can do the procedure is Randall Hospital?
Correct.
Froese turned to Quentin.
Ganagati owns the place.
I'm a partner. I don't own it outright.
The commissioner waved a hand dismissively.
I don't care who owns it, and I don't care what this procedure costs. If there's any chance for Barnes to play again, we need to pursue it.
Quentin nodded.
I realize the GFL is a business, Commissioner, but the probability is that Mr. Barnes will not be suitable for this procedure. If he is, his chance of being cured is statistically small, while his chance of ending up in incurable, agonizing pain is statistically high. Commissioner, are you certain you want to take that chance with such a popular player? Wouldn't he be of more value to you, retired, than dead?
Even with a pair of championships under his belt, Quentin knew he had yet to reach his prime as a quarterback. When he finally hung up his cleats, he wanted there to be no question that he was the GOAT, the greatest of all time.
The choice is his, of course. But as the commissioner of the league, I'm willing to exhaust all possibilities. Barnes isn't just another player. He is, without a doubt, the most well-known sentient being in history. Before Barnes joined the upper tiers, the GFL was already the galaxy's most popular sport. We were seeing small, incremental viewership increases. Since he's come on the scene, our ratings have gone up season after season, by double digits. Over 1 billion replica Barnes jerseys have been sold. The bids for broadcast rights of the upcoming GFL season will be triple what they were just 5 seasons ago.
Ganagati's hollow body shivered.
Mr. Barnes is a sentient being. Isn't his life more valuable than his ability to throw a football?
Frost loosened his tie.
It's my job to increase the value of the league. As far as the GFL is concerned, keeping Quentin Barnes on the field is worth any risk.
Let me at least do the scan. If I'm not suitable for the procedure, then that's that. If I am, we can make the decision.
Ganagati shivered again.
We will do the scan.
Frost nodded.
Good. Right now, the only people who know Quentin is going to Earth are in this room. Let's keep it that way.
At the regulator's next punch stop, I'll disembark. I'll travel to Earth. I'll set up a false patient record and make sure no one in the hospital knows Barnes is coming. Once he arrives, I can do nothing to hide someone so recognizable.
That works. Barnes, I'll arrange a non-GFL ship to take you to Earth, and I'll handpick a group of bodyguards as your escort. Sentients I know I can trust.
Well, you might trust them, but I don't. I'm taking the Hypatia. Chodo, Becca, and my pilot go with me.
Frost gave a conciliatory nod.
I'll see if I can arrange a false temporary registration for your yacht. At least no one will see the ship's real name. Nothing we can do about how it looks, though. You sure you can't take another ship?
The Portith had upgraded the vessel, coating it in platinum iridium armor. The Hypatia now looked more like an alien warship than the pleasure yacht it had once been.
My yacht or nothing. I've been through a lot with that ship. I'll leave with the regulator's next punch-out. Might as well head for Earth as soon as possible and get this thing done.
Frost's expression softened.
Barnes, you've been out of it for a few days. Our next stop is for Hokor's solidity ceremony.
Quentin nodded at the mention of the Quith equivalent of a funeral as grief crushed him all over again.
After the service, then. I'll leave when it's done.
In the meantime, you have obligations to the League. The media is screaming for interviews with the 2-time champ.
No interviews.
Frost rubbed his face.
Barnes, you have to do interviews. The galaxy's greatest sports show won't take no for an answer. And GNN is doing a story covering your impact on the purest nation. They want a response for a piece that's running next month. Not to mention you'll end at Davenport and...
No interviews. You don't like it? Then kick me out of the league.
All right, Barnes. No interviews. I know you're going through a lot. I'm sorry to make you go through more, but I need to see you in my office. Alone.
It's not good for me to be alone right now. I need to bring Becca.
Fine. As soon as you're done with the exam, Wycor the Aware will come for you in Montaigne. You and I have a lot to cover.
Frost walked out, leaving Quentin alone with Ganagati. He looked at the doctor, floating there, watched her skin stretch across her ribs as she breathed.
My career is over. That's what you think, right?
Mr. Barnes, I will do everything in my ability to help you.
The lack of a straightforward answer told him everything. It meant there was a chance, and with that chance, he would show her. He would show Doc Pata. He would show them all. Missal stepped through the chamber doors, followed by a tall, thin, balding human male dressed in a white suit. The human carried a small black case and wore a false smile.
Mr. Zogby to see you, Shamakath.
Leave us.
Missal left the chamber, silently closing the doors behind him.
Gredok, hello. I wanted to let you know personally that the championship rings will be ready shortly after Hokor's solidity service.
The human paused, perhaps waiting for an answer. Gredok said nothing.
Well then, I have a new setting to show you. I think you will be very pleased.
Zogby approached the base of Gredok's pedestal. He opened the case and held it up for Gredok to see. A gleaming necklace of stunning craftsmanship, made of rhodium most likely, engraved with lines of Eptinium, a metal found only on Orbital Station 3, Hokor's homeworld. The Christeal statue of Hokor was one thing, but the hook chest's final solidity would be with Gredok at all times. The necklace was exceptional, and yet not quite right. Gredok stared at the human jeweler.
The setting is not exalted enough. Do you not understand the importance of Hokor the Hook Chest?
Zogby was nodding before Gredok finished his question.
Oh, Oh, yes, of course, of course. Exalted, a powerful word. I should have had that word in my head from the beginning. I sincerely apologize for missing the mark. I will have more settings shipped here immediately. Far better settings, I assure you.
Zogby closed the case. His trembling hands held it against his chest. Sweat on his upper lip, on his nose, on his forehead, on his scalp that carried only a few long strands of thin hair. Gredok heard the man's hammering heart, examined his dilated pupils.
Better settings. Considering the priceless value of my time, I find it interesting that you do not bring your best choices from the very start. Or do you think that I am so bereft with grief that I am susceptible to purchasing a lesser quality piece?
Zogby blinked rapidly.
Beauty is subjective, Gredok. I have shown you what I thought were our most stunning pieces, but now I clearly see I evaluated quality with my paltry human eyes. I did not properly consider the exacting standards of a high-ranking Quith leader. This time, I will bring everything we have, and hopefully there will be something to your liking.
See that you do. You would hate to lose my business.
Zogby nodded rapidly, enough to make his thin strands of hair fall out of place.
Of course, Gredok. You are our most important customer, after all.
The human swept his hand over his head. Zogby bowed as he shuffled backward, away from the pedestal. With the attack on the touchback and with Barnes on the regulator, Gredok had undoubtedly lost face. The galaxy needed a reminder of the Splithead's power and influence. The chamber doors opened, Missal came through alone, and clearly frightened.
Shamakov, a messenger from Commissioner Froze just arrived via Courier Express.
Most galactic communication took place via punch relay, a chain of FTL-capable beacons that were timed on specific departure schedules, which allowed data to move far faster than it could on one beacon alone, since a single beacon, like every other FTL-capable ship, had to recharge its drives between punches. The data express system was like the relay system, but more secure and costly. The priciest method of all? Sending a sentient being via Courier Express. Data could be instantly transmitted from an arriving beacon to a departing one. Living beings could not. Couriers needed to board a ship, punch to the next location, then transfer to another waiting ship. That reduced the downtime of each stop from several hours to usually 30 minutes or less. Gredok himself had traveled via express relay several times when he wanted to ensure the intended recipient couldn't pretend an electronic communication had never arrived or to make sure there was no electronic copy of the message. In two instances, Gredok had traveled via express relay to make sure he reached a particular sentient before any warning signal could. Surprise always proved to be a satisfying advantage.
Froze sent an actual messenger to me. This must be important.
It is, Shamakov. It is about...
Missal began to tremble as a curl of pink danced across his cornea.
Out with it.
Shamakov, it is about Hokor's solidity ceremony.
There was ample traffic in the regulator's corridors. Sentients walking or flying this way or that. Humans of many skin tones, workers, warriors, and leaders with various fur colors, a few key. A few male sclerno furballs scurrying along the floor, perhaps the League was trying to be diverse in its hiring. Everyone, though, offered a smile, a nod, or some species-specific sign of respect to Quentin and Becca, most recent GFL champs. Wycor was almost comical in appearance, in that he dressed like a worker version of Commissioner Froze. White button-down shirt, red tie cinched around the collar that circled his torso just under his muscled pedipalp arms.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.